ॐ वसुदेवसुतं देवं कंसचाणूरमर्दनं देवकी परमानंदं कृष्णं वंदे जगद्गुरुं असतो मा सद्गमाय तमसो मा ज्योतिर्गमय मृत्योर्मामृतंगमय ॐ शांति शांति शांति। Let us offer the salutations to Lord Krishna, the embodiment of bliss, who came to establish Dharma and punish the wicked. Let us pray to him to lead us from unreal to real, to lead us from darkness of ignorance to light of knowledge, to lead us from death to immortality. We have been studying Chapter 10, Vibhuti Yoga, that is the Yoga of Divine Manifestations. Here Lord Krishna wants to know us that the whole universe with everything in it, they all belong to Him. They are projected by Him. They are created by Him. So, in a way, nothing belongs to any individual being here. Everything belongs to the Supreme Divine. And the concept of creation, administration, hierarchy, all these things well organized by the Divine Lord. And all the beings are to play their divine game in this universe. We are all playing the game, though we may not know it, but it is nothing but game only. The game comes to an end only when we realize the Divine. Sri Ramakrishna used to say, I didn't see game in the Gospel. People try to search, try to touch the person. But whoever touches a granny is released. It is just like that. Now, in the last class, I just quoted the verse number 4 and 5, which verse I am taking again now. Buddhirjnanam sammohaha kshama satyam namashyamaha sukham dukkham bhavo bhavo bhayamcha bhayamevacha ahimsa samata tushtihi tapodanam yashoyashaha bhavanti bhava bhutanam mattayeva kritagvihaha. So, a list of qualities are given here. Intelligence, wisdom, non-delusion, forbearance, truth, sense control, calmness, happiness, misery, birth, death, fear, as well as fearlessness. Then Lord Krishna continues, Ahimsa samata tushtihi tapo danam yasho yasah bhavanti bhava bhutanam matta eva kritagvidaha. Non-injury, equanimity, contentment, austerity, charity, fame, as well as ill fame. All these different kinds of qualities of beings arise from me alone. So Sri Krishna tells everything is projected by Him. All these things are provided so that the game should go well. Without any tools, how can the game go on? So, for this vast universe, Paramatman is the cause. Just as from the seed, the tree arises with branches, twigs, leaves, flowers, etc. From the seed of Paramatman has arisen the universe with infinite varieties. If one sees through proper discrimination, which is called intelligence, he finds that the Lord is present in and out of everything in the universe. So in that sense, everything in the universe is sacred. So you must look upon things in this universe as very sacred. This universe is said to be vast open scripture. The Lord is present in every syllable of this great book. One who is capable of reading the words of this great book called universe would be able to realize the Lord. Now, Sri Krishna mentions here intelligence, that is buddhi. Buddhi is the power which the inner sense, antakkaran, has of understanding subtle objects of thought. There is sukshma buddhi, tikshna buddhi. He indeed is said to be intelligent who is possessed of this power. Rational thinking is considered as intelligence. The power to distinguish between what is duty and what is not. What is good, what is bad, what is profitable, what is destructive. So, by the use of the intelligence, you should be able to distinguish them correctly. In the Brahmavivarta Purana, it is said as Buddhi Vivechana Rupava Jnani Jnana Jnanisutava. The power of discriminating faculty is said to be Buddhi. That's about intelligence. Everyone is possessed with intelligence, but very few try to sharpen the intelligence. In a way, they don't give any attention to refine the intelligence. So they behave in a crude way from birth to death, losing the fine opportunity of using the power of intelligence. That is buddhi. Then comes jnana. Jnana is wisdom. It is a knowledge of the self and other such things. What is Atman? How does it look? What is its nature? What is its duration? And so on. All connected with the self is considered wisdom. It is to know the nature of the embodied being, the universe, Ishvara. That is, it is to know the real nature of the thing. To know the real nature of the thing is called jnanam, wisdom. Then asambhavaha, non-delusion. It consists in acting with discrimination when anything has to be done or known at the moment. Next is kshama, forbearance. Not being agitated in mind when assaulted or abused. Then satyam, truth. Giving utterance to one's own actual experience of things as heard or seen with a view to impress it on the mind of another. That is, not telling the lies. Then tamaha, Tamaha means self-restraint, quieting the external senses. Then comes Shamaha, calmness, the tranquility of the inner sense or antakkaran. Sukham, happiness, the joy one gets in the mind when things are accomplished according to his liking, and the joy one gets by that. And then when one gets joy, when obstructions or problems are removed, this is called Sukham. Dukkham means misery. When unfavorable things happen and meet with unpleasant situations, mind becomes sad. Then birth, creation of sentient and insentient beings. Then abhavaha, death. Anything that is created has subsided. So janan maran go alternately. Then fear, there is bhayam. The greatest enemy of man is fear. This is demonic nature. All the good qualities in a fearful person become vain. Anticipating some bad thing causes ripples in his mind, which is said to be fear. If you see animals, how they ran out of sheer fear, feels they're terribly afraid of. Then fearlessness, the 13th quality. Fearlessness means abhaya. The grief. Now, this abhaya is to be recognized and cultivated. The natural tendency of the person is to be fearful. So, the great friend of a person is fearlessness. He is not shaken by any anticipating difficulties or situations. Then non-injury, that is ahimsa. He will not harm any being through his mind, words or deeds. Truly speaking, not knowing oneself is said to be harming. Knowing oneself is non-injury, ahimsa. So it is said in the Vedas, ahimso paramo dharmaha. The greatest dharma is ahimsa. Then equanimity, samatha, tranquility of mind in all situations and circumstances. Then contentment, tushti, being satisfied with one's present acquisitions. Real contentment is acquired through the realization of the Atman. The contentment one gets through the objects of the senses is temporary. Next is tapaha, austerity. Tolerating difficulties calmly while practicing spiritual disciplines is said to be tapas. Worshipping God, serving holy person, serving guru, maintaining celibacy, purity, being humble and non-violent, these are said to be shariraka tapas. Regarding this tapas, in the some other chapter, Bhagavad Gita also deals with non-excitement, truthful, loving, consoling words, study of the scriptures. These are said to be tapas of speech. Vangmaya tapaha. Cheerfulness of mind, gentleness, silence, mind control, pure thoughts, all these are said to be manasika tapas. By tapas, all the disturbances are burnt. As gold is purified through burning in high temperature furnace, the senses are purified through tapas. Then charity, dana. When a person acquiring wealth by proper means gives away for a noble cause is called as charity. It purifies one's heart. It is said to be sattvika dana. Then yashah. When a person does lot of philanthropic services, always trying to help others, such a person will be highly appreciated and recognized by the people. It is called fame. By such activities, one becomes cheerful. His status is raised in the society. So he wants to be recognized by the society and he is happy to experience that yashas. Then ill fame, ayashaha. One gets bad name when one engages in bad activities and is caught up in scandals. Such a person becomes shameful and is ever sorrowful. All these qualities arise from the Lord of the universe alone, according to their respective karmas. According to your respective karmas. So, karmas play very, very important role in everyone's life. Knowingly or unknowingly, whatever you do, will have its results. They do come. Ishvara, Lord of the universe, is karma pradata, giver of fruits of actions. He is the karma pradata. The embodied beings are the performance of karma. That is, they are called as karma karta. So we are all karma kartas. Karma paladhata is the Lord of the universe. According to the nature of seeds put in the earth, one gets fruits thereby. Earth and water are beyond any favoritism. That's all about this verse number 5, 4 and 5. Now we shall go to next verse, verse number 6. Maharshaya saptapurve chattvaro manamastatha madbhava manasajatha esham loka imahtajaha. The seven great sages, that is saptarshis, and the four manus of the ancient times, possessed of powers like me, on account of their minds being fixed on me, that is Sri Krishna, referring to himself. They are born of my mind. From them are these creatures born in this world. The seven great rishis, Bhrugu, Marichi, Atri, Putaha, Pulastya, Kratu and Angiras. The four ancient manus are Savarochisha, Swayambhu, Raivata and Uttama. These kings are not of human origin. They are all born of the mind of Brahman. Brahma, creator. In other words, they are all personifications of the several phases of the cosmic reality. The seven great rishis represent the seven planes of consciousness. They are therefore said to be the originators of beings at all levels of existence and all grades of evolution. While the seven rishis represent the created beings in their entirety, the four ancient manus function as the orderly administrators of the entire creation. The precision and regularity evinced by nature are all due to the efficient regime of the manus. What is the benefit that the sadhaka derives by knowing the structure of the cosmos and its orderly functioning? That is, statement in the next verse. Etam vibhutim yogancha namayo vetti tattvataha sovikampena yogena yujyate nata samshayaha. He who knows the truth, he who knows in truth this glory and power of mind, he is endowed with unfaltering yoga. Of this there is no doubt. The word used is vibhuti. Vibhuti means glory or sovereignty. And the word vibhuti contains two ideas. The idea of power or lordship. Secondly, the idea of pervasion or immanence or emanation. In this chapter, Sri Krishna recounts to Arjuna some of his vibhutis, that is objects revealing his lordship or power, his immanence in them. Krishna speaks to himself as the chief of the lord of each class. Example, the sun among lights, and as the immanent energy or shakti, each member of the class exists only through participation in that shakti. For example, lights owe their possession of light to the sun. Electricity manifests itself in various forms and instruments suited to those forms. In whatever form this energy expresses itself, the power is the same. This is a specimen of the primordial power of the Lord, evolving itself into the glorious varieties of sentient to the insentient, abounding in nature. The discerning man knows that whatever he senses is the power and glory of Ishvara. He cannot therefore be any more separate from Ishvara than he can be separate from earth. His yoga with God is thereby made unfaltering. Sri Ramakrishna says, a lamp cannot burn without oil. Even so, man cannot be bereft of God. Verse number 8. Aham sarvasya pramavo mattaha sarvam pravartate iti matva bhajante mam udha bhavasamanvitaha. Sri Krishna says further, I am the source of all. From me all things evolve. The wise know this and worship me with all their heart. The Supreme Brahma, termed Vasudeva, I am the source of the whole world. Sri Krishna says, from me alone evolves the whole universe in all its changes, including existence and disappearance, action, effect and enjoyment. Thus thinking, the wise who know the Supreme Reality worship me, ardently engaged in the contemplation of the same Supreme Reality. Controlled and impelled by me as the inner regulator, everything moves on in accordance with the law. It's only those who see the emptiness of the worldly life that are fit for a life of devotion to the Lord. When men know the Lord as the self of all, the cause of all, the omniscient Lord of all, they become devoted to me. The knowledge of the Supreme Reality leads to love, regard and earnestness, and these lead to devotion to the Lord. So, one should definitely not be trapped by the world, but he should earnestly struggle to get released from the trapping of the world. Machitta madgata prana bodhayanta parasparam kadayantasta mam nityam tushyantacha namanticha. With their mind fixed on me, with their senses absorbed in me, enlightening each other and ever speaking of me, they remain contented and happy. Those who are devoted, whose mind is fully occupied by the divine thought, they always rejoice in the glory of God. They talk nothing else but about the divine. And that is true. If you come across a real holy person, he always speaks about the divine. But I used to say in the previous class also, the president of the Ramakrishna Order, Swami Vishuddhanandji, always after the prayer, everybody would go to make pranam to Swamiji, the Bhimamat. The big line, they would stand and one by one they go and touch the feet of Swamiji, take blessings. And before we could go there, there would be 40-50 people sitting around Vishuddhanandji. And Swamiji was talking. What is talking? He is talking about Holy Mother. Whole day, all the time, he will be talking about Holy Mother. I don't know how much he has got knowledge about Holy Mother, but that's the way it is. And people would hear with rapt attention. What I mean to say, their mind does not go anywhere else. They are well established in their devotion to the divine, and they feel more and more happy in talking about the divine. So that's how it is. Once you get devotion, once your mind is absorbed in the divine whom you are worshipping, then you want nothing but the divine. And your love, all your love extends towards the divine whom you are worshipping. So, and the person will be in perpetual joy, who is always contemplating on the divine earnestly, with steadfastness. So he feels greatly elated by such things. Desham satrayuktana bhajatam prithipurvakam dadami buddhi yogam tam yenamam upayantite. To them who are ever steadfast, worshipping me with love, Sri Krishna says, I give the yoga of discrimination by which they come to me. That means they will be endowed with the knowledge. Knowledge. Through that knowledge, they pursue and reach the Divine Supreme. The devotees who have dedicated themselves to the Lord, who are ever harmonious and self-abiding, who adore Him with intense love, who are ever devout, obtain the divine grace. Like that it is. Verse number 11. Tesham evanukampartham ahamajnanajam tamaha nashayan atmabhavastu jnanadipena bhaskata. Purely out of compassion for them, Sri Krishna says, I dwelling in their hearts, destroy the darkness born of ignorance by the luminous lamp of knowledge. The Lord's choosing to reside in the hearts of beings is His compassion. Because of His presence as conscience, beings are prompted to seek what is good, or at least what seems good. The lamp of wisdom that the Lord lights is constituted of divine components. Discrimination functions as the container of oil. The contentment coming from devotion is the oil The flame gets put out by foul air, but this flame is fed by the pure air of meditation on Ishvara. Prajna, or the awareness of the self, ensuing from the constant brahmacharya, sarasativik, the heart freed from all worries and anxieties, is a lamp needs. A burning lamp runs the risk of being blown out by a gust, but a mind unaffected by attachment and aversion is the best windscreen to this lamp. The unbroken consciousness of Ishvara is a flame emanating from this lamp of wisdom set up in the heart of the devotee. He beholds the divine presence within himself with the aid of this divine lamp. Sri Ramakrishna gives an example in the Gospel. The policeman patrolling at night carries a bullseye lantern with the aid of which he sees the persons loitering about. But this lantern does not disclose its carrier. If he, however, turns it on himself, the others then come to know who he is. Likewise, Ishvara reveals nature and its contents, but keeps himself hidden. Nobody can see him except through his grace and compassion. God is ever compassionate and graceful. Only he sees our sincerity. If we are sincere and making our efforts, God will definitely bestow his grace. Param Brahma Param Dhama Pavitram Paramam Bhavan Purusham Shashvatam Divyam Adidevam Sambhu. Arjuna said, O Lord, O Krishna, you are the Supreme Brahman, the Supreme Abode, or the Supreme Light, the Supreme Purifier, the Eternal Divine Person, the Primal God, unborn and omnipresent. So like that, Arjuna expresses great devotion towards Krishna. Param Brahma means Supreme Brahma, Nirguna, Nirupadika Brahma, the pure consciousness, is called Param Brahma. Apara Brahma is Ishvara, Saguna Brahma, the reality with all attributes and glory. Paranthama means it is substratum of everything manifest and unmanifest, the Supreme Abode. Avastvam Shriya Sarve Devasya Naradastata Asito Devalo Vyasa Swayamcheva Pravishime. All the sages have thus declared you, O Krishna, as also the Divine Sage Narada, so also Asita, Devala and Vyasa, and now you yourself are telling me so. So all the rishis are extolling the glory of the Divine Lord. Narad is a Devarshi, teacher of the gods. He is one of the greatest of the Lord's bhaktas, singing the glories of the Lord on his veena. Devala is the son of Vishwamitra, which is mentioned in Vishnu Purana. Asita is mentioned in the Lilita Vistara. Vyasa, also called Krishna Dvaipayana, compiled the Vedas and was also the author of Mahabharata and the Puranas. So all these rishis have declared the supremacy of the Divine Lord. Sarvamitritam manye yanma marzi keshava nahite bhagavan vyaktim viduddevana dhanavaha. I hold as true all that you have said to me, O Krishna. Verily, neither the gods nor the demons, O Lord, know your manifestations. Bhagavan is he who fully manifests six divine qualities, which are Bala, omnipresence, omnipotence, Dharma, righteousness, Aishwarya, lordship, Shri, wealth and beauty, Jnana, wisdom, Vairagya, dispassion, all these six qualities are manifested in Bhagavan. Further, he knows the past, present and future of beings. His manifestation in human form remains unknown to the devatas themselves. How then shall the dharmas and asuras come to know how his intention extends? Sri Ramakrishna used to say, the sun is immensely greater than the earth, but because of the distance, it appears as a small disk. In this wise, Ishwara's attributes are infinite, but we know very little of it because of our ignorance. So like that here, Lord Krishna explains his glorious manifestations so that we know the nature of the divine and accordingly we should develop our proper devotion to him. Let us continue next Tuesday. Om Vasudeva Sutam Devam Kamsachanuramardhanam Devaki Paramanandam Krishna Vande Jagadgurum. Let us offer our salutations to Lord Krishna, the embodiment of this, who came to establish Dharma and punish the wicked. Peace, peace, peace be to all.